Hey, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to our monthly Innovations in Tobacco Control seminar. I'm Joanna Cohen. I'm the director of the Institute for Global Tobacco Control, and today I'm delighted to be able to introduce Dr. Richard Edwards. He's here, well, he's been in the U.S., but he's really coming to us from the University of Otago in Wellington, New Zealand. There he is the co-head of the Department of Public Health, and he also co-directs the Aspire 2025 program, which is basically like a research theme, thinking about the future and the end game of tobacco control, the end game for tobacco in New Zealand. Dr. Edwards is a public health physician. He's trained in medicine and also has some training in political science. He has an MPH degree. He's a member of the Royal College of Physicians. He started his career in the UK and has been in New Zealand for the past 11 years or so. And he's really worked on a whole range of tobacco control issues in terms of his research. He teaches a course on epidemiology and biostatistics, and he's certainly done epidemiology type studies in tobacco control, but has also worked in areas of smoke-free, knowledge and attitudes towards stronger tobacco control policies. He's worked on point-of-sale issues and a whole range of, and particularly more recently, really looking at the end game and what that means and how we can get there. So, Dr. Edwards, welcome, and we're really excited to hear about how New Zealand is thinking about this issue and what we can learn from you. So thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Joanna, and thank you for inviting me here, and thank you for all the wonderful people I've met, and I've got a few more to meet this afternoon. It's been a really good experience. So I'm talking about Smokefree 2025 and Aspire 2025, which is our research collaboration who hopes to do research to help achieve it. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to mention something about New Zealand. I'm going to talk about the Smokefree 2025 and then give some examples of the sort of research we've done in Aspire to try and move towards that, and some of the lessons that we've learned along the way. And it's mainly policy-oriented research. And I'm going to finish on with some reflections on the end game idea. So first of all, where I come from is Wellington in New Zealand. So these are the sort of the marketing commercials for New Zealand. So this is Wellington and the harbour. We sometimes get orcas there. This was a couple of weeks ago. We had a rather nice rainbow. It doesn't always look like that, I mean, I must be honest, but it can do on a good day. And New Zealand has some beautiful country. This was us doing a hike about 4 weeks ago on a thing called the Rootburn Track on South Island. And this is Milford Sound, which is a sort of fjord area on South Island, which is just incredibly stunning. So if you're ever thinking of coming to New Zealand, it's really well worthwhile. We also have, I don't know whether anyone recognizes this from films and things. So this is Mount Doom, or it's Mount Naraharu. It's an inactive volcano. So there's the Lord of the Rings connection, and that's quite a prominent thing. This is Wellington Airport. This is Gollum, for those who don't know, and we've got these sort of eagles flying around. We also have a little bit of a problem with volcanoes and earthquakes and pretty much anything you can think of in New Zealand, and Wellington's certainly on a few fault lines, and we had a shake a few months ago, and one of the eagles fell down. I'm assured that they've now strengthened it, and no one was underneath it, so they didn't get squashed. But that's a little bit about New Zealand. So going on back to Smokefree 2025, I won't go through the detail of this, but just to say that Smokefree 2025 has, like any of these sorts of ideas, has a genesis and a context to it. And one of the bits of context about this is that the indigenous people of New Zealand are the Maori, and they make up about 15% of the population. And this was really a Maori-driven, led idea that we want to not just reduce smoking, we want to get rid of it. And so there's various Maori political leaders and tobacco control leaders who really pushed this idea. And the reason it was so so pertinent to Maori was because of very high smoking rates and very high lung cancer rates and so on. So there was a preceding various visions that were put forward. But the really, the sort of landmark thing was there's a select committee of the New Zealand Parliament which did an investigation into the tobacco industry and its consequences for Maori. So this is a Maori-led select committee of MPs. And one of their recommendations was that we have a goal to get rid of smoking altogether and make New Zealand a smoke-free nation by 2025. So this wasn't a government goal at this stage. This was the a group of MPs saying this was what we should do. Now, this select committee is quite influential, and the government has to respond to its reports. So we waited to see what the government would say. So this came out in 2010. And about 6 months later, the government issued its response. And to be honest, we were a little bit surprised because we weren't expecting much. We were expecting to say, oh, yes, that's very interesting, but you know, we're not going to do anything about it. But they came out with this. So this was the government response. They talked about it being an aspirational goal, but nevertheless, they said the government agrees with the longer-term goal of reducing smoking prevalence and tobacco availability to minimal levels, thereby making New Zealand essentially a smoke-free nation by 2025. So we were, you know, pretty blown away with this. This was the government saying this is the goal, to get rid of tobacco. And I'm not sure if we were the first country. I think you could say Finland was the first country to adopt such a goal. I mean, it doesn't really matter. But one of the first places, anyway, to have a government goal. So this really changed the landscape of things, because we now had this. The government was committed to getting rid of tobacco in 14 years' time, because this was 2011. So what's happened in tobacco control in New Zealand over the years? New Zealand's done a lot of stuff. I mean, I wouldn't say it's the leading country, but it's certainly up there with a lot of the countries like Australia and the UK and the US and various that have done a lot of things. So these are some of the things we've done. And two of the key ones was this. In 1990, there was a thing called the Smoke-Free Environments Act that made pretty much all indoor workplaces smoke-free, not bars and restaurants, but most of the others, and banned advertising. So TV advertising had already been banned, but print advertising, billboard advertising, and so on, and announced an end to sponsorship, but that was phased in whilst the sponsors were replaced. So it became like a dark market in those terms. So that was quite important. And then in 2004, we brought in the national smoke-free legislation to get rid of smoking in bars and restaurants, as had been done in Ireland and Norway just before. But, you know, a load of other things like quit lines and pictorial health warnings, etc. So this was the sort of context in 2010. Quite a lot of stuff had already been done, and we now had this goal. So what happened since in terms of policy? Well, there's been a few things. So one thing was prisons were made completely smoke-free in 2011. And by smoke-free, that means there's no smoking allowed anywhere in prisons for the inmates or the staff. So that was, you know, we all know that smoking rates amongst prisoners are 80 or 90%. You know, it's incredibly high. So this is not a trivial thing to do. And it seemed to work pretty well, although it's not been very well evaluated, but we don't hear too much that it's not working. Point-of-sale displays were banned in 2012. We had no point-of-sale display advertising, but we still had the displays of the products, and they were got rid of in 2012, and I'll talk about some of the research behind that shortly. Duty-free allowances before 2014, you could bring in 200 cigarettes duty-free, and that was reduced in 2014 to 50. So we would have liked to get rid of it altogether. I mean, duty-free cigarettes is an insane idea, in my opinion. Why on earth would you allow that? But anyway, we got it down to 50. Taxes, there's been steady increases in taxes since 2010, and before that there wasn't. There was about a 10-year period when it just went up with inflation. So the real price of cigarettes was going down as wages grew more than inflation. But since 2010, there's been big increases in tax every year, 10% above inflation, and that's continuing to 2021, so that's good. And then in terms of smoke-free outdoors, this is a map of New Zealand showing places which have introduced things like smoke-free beaches, parks, playgrounds, malls, and so on. There's no national legislation on this. This is all local activity. And these tend to be voluntary policies, but that doesn't seem to matter too much. They seem to be adhered to quite well. So there's a lot going on, and indeed there's a lot of activity at local level, whether that be at council level or sort of health board level or just different localities doing things about smoking. And then plain packaging or standardised packaging. Australia introduced this in 2011 or 12, I think it was. And New Zealand announced that they intended to follow and be the next country. They weren't the next country, and they've been sort of vacillating and waiting for the court cases and the WTO cases, etc. But finally, last year, they did commit to introducing, firmly commit, and it is, I think, now inevitable, unless something really unexpected happens. And it will happen probably in early 2018. So that's good. So there's lots of positive things going on in a sort of policy type perspective. And we've had some mass media, I'll come back to some of the underlying thinking behind this, but this is a mass media campaign aimed at young adults and getting across to young adults that when you start a relationship when you start smoking, which may not be a good one, and this is supposed to be an unattractive figure. And this has been a themed campaign trying to get young adults not to start smoking. But as usual, there's sort of glass half empty, glass half full type perspective. So there's lots also that we're very frustrated about in terms of progress. And one of those is going back to the mass media. So some places, I think, have done mass media incredibly well, and I think the US is one of those, in particular in California and some particular states. Australia has been, has really well-resourced, hard-hitting campaigns. New Zealand's have been less well-resourced and perhaps a bit less hard-hitting. And this, I'm showing this as this is an exception. So this is a campaign from about 6 or 7 years ago, which Te Reo Marama ran, and they were the National Māori Advocacy Service for Tobacco Control. So this campaign, this one here, this is pretty hard-hitting stuff. They're talking about the tobacco industry murdering Māori. And this endangered species, so it's legal genocide, endangered species. And endangered species has a real resonance here because in the process of colonization, Māori were decimated, and towards the end of the 19th century, commentators were saying, oh, we think Māori are going to disappear from New Zealand. They didn't, and they've come back, and they make 15% of the population. But this sort of metaphor of endangered species has a huge resonance with Māori populations, and the idea here is that the tobacco industry is making us endangered. So this is really powerful stuff. So this, I would say this is good. But this was very poorly resourced, and this was not a mass campaign. So the people who are aware of this campaign are people like me. And, that's the last people who need to know about it. So this has not been well disseminated, if you like. And if you look at mass media expenditure, and we did this a couple of years ago, so the smoke-free goal came in 2011. And this is overall mass media expenditure here. You see it actually went down. Now, if you've introduced a 2025 goal to get rid of tobacco altogether, and you've got tax going up, so revenue income from tobacco tax is increasing, you might think you would increase the mass media, but the government has done the opposite. So it's not, the picture is not all good. This is impossible to understand, I think. Okay, so just looking at some of the research that we've been involved in, and I'm just going to go through some endgame type examples. Point of sale research, just an example of how we did a sort of little program of research, and which had, I think, had some impact. And then some other miscellaneous examples, and I'll just mention ITC. That's just our report. So this is our group, or the people in it at the moment. The one person I want to point out here, I'll mention her later. This is Tariana Turia. She is the Associate Minister of Health. She's a Māori. And she had responsibility for tobacco control in the government until September 2014. And she was an absolute champion for Smokefree 2025. So I just want to acknowledge her. These are the people we work with. And one of the key things here is there's all the usual sort of university types. But we work a lot with the sort of the advocacy type organizations. So Cancer Society, ASH, this is the new Māori advocacy service, etc. So we've done research in lots of different areas, and obviously I'm not going to go through all of these, but one of the things about being in New Zealand is it's a small country, small pool of people. You sort of have to be a generalist in terms of topic and methodology. So I suppose if anything, I'm trained as an epidemiologist, but we do a lot of qualitative research. We're pretty eclectic about methods. We do what we think is the best method to use for whatever the purpose is. And we've done on all these sorts of areas of research. I'm not going to talk much about e-cigarettes or smoking cessation or tax, but some of the other areas I will. So one of the things, in terms of endgames, one of the early things we did was a project called Daring to Dream. And this was from about 2008, 2009, we collected the data, I think. And in this was when the idea of an endgame was quite a new one, and we wanted to see how it played out, and also how some sort of radical ideas about how you might achieve an endgame would play out as well, and would they be understood. But in terms of just the idea of an endgame, what we found was it was a really powerful concept with the public and to a certain degree with policymakers and practitioners, but particularly with the public. So when we talked about this idea of a New Zealand where children had minimal risks of ever likely being exposed to smoking in any way or starting smoking, you know, people found that a very compelling vision, even smokers and non-smokers. So that was just one of our starting points. And I think framing it in a very positive and way is obviously important. And this is some more sort of survey type information where we've asked the public here, so this is smokers and non-smokers, do you support the goal of, this is the sort of official endgame goal of reducing to minimal levels, which is often interpreted as about 5% or less. We want to get it as low as possible. And you can see here there is absolutely massive and overwhelming support. And similarly, when we ask about this, I want to live in a country where hardly anyone smokes, again, overwhelming support. Not quite so strong amongst smokers, but still very strong. And then this one, so this is not in the end game, that there's nothing about actually prohibiting sale. It says about reducing availability, but not prohibiting it. But there's even, you know, strong support for saying, we don't want tobacco to be sold at all in 10 years' time. So that's quite a radical idea, and yet it's got strong majority support. So these ideas are, you know, they're popular, at least in New Zealand. This is a more qualitative approach, so this is talking to young adult smokers, and we asked them about this, and we got things like this. You know, this is awesome, makes me really proud to be a New Zealander. And one of the things that context of New Zealand, I mean, every country has its sort of national identity type things. And in New Zealand, there's a few things that people are very proud of. And some of those are quite socially progressive things. Not that it's a particularly left-wing country, it's probably more center-right overall, but it's got one or two things it's really proud of. One is New Zealand was the first country to give universal suffrage to women, first democracy to do that. New Zealand became completely nuclear-free in, I think, the 1980s. And again, that's become sort of, even amongst people who are quite right-wing, they're quite proud of the fact that we have no nuclear power, we'd have no nuclear-powered ships or armed ships or whatever. Nothing's allowed in New Zealand, or nothing we know of, anyway. And we think, well, you know, this could be the same sort of thing. We can be proud as New Zealanders to have got rid of smoking. So young smokers talking about, yeah, it's pretty cool. I'm a smoker now, but I don't want to be. This one saying, yeah, I'll be pretty pissed off with it, but actually, it's probably a good thing. So you're getting slightly more lukewarm. And then this one saying, yeah, great idea, but don't know if you can do it, which is, you know, fair point. And then sometimes you get the odd person who doesn't agree with you. But overwhelmingly, that was not the main sentiment, but it was some people. So one of the things, of course, we have to do is, well, how are we doing? And, you know, how are we doing in terms of prevalence? And we've got three big national surveys in New Zealand, two sort of cross-sectional sample-based surveys, and we also have a census. And we ask about smoking in the census. So New Zealand has a population of 4.5 million people, so we've got a prevalence survey, if you like, of 4 million or however many adults there are, which is pretty big. I think we think it's the biggest prevalence survey in the world. And these different sources show slightly different things, but what we've done here is try to put them together. And the first thing is, this is Māori smoking. Here, this is 40%, and this is Māori smoking. This is European other, and this is close to the overall because they're the biggest proportion of the population. So you can see, first of all, there's an enormous disparity. Māori are, you know, two or three times more smoking prevalence. And one of the things we've always said about Smokefree 2025 is we need to achieve Smokefree 2025 for all groups in the population. Achieving it just overall, but leaving it with 20% of Maori smoking, that is not achieving Smokefree 2025. We've got to get it down to 5%. Pacifica people are somewhere in between, and Asian people, Chinese, Indian people are very low. But if we want to achieve it, clearly we've got a massive job, particularly for Maori. So we're, and it looks like in recent years it seems to have leveled off, if anything. So this is pretty worrying. So although there's been some good policy stuff in terms of prevalence, there's no way we're going to get there on current projections. That's just a very crude thing, but we work with a group called BODE who do much more sophisticated projections based on sort of complex models and so on. And they reckon that actually on current projections, we'll get close. This is with different tax levels, modeling different tax levels. We'll get close for the overall population, but if you do this for Maori, it's like 20 or 25% or something at 2025, nowhere near. So we're not doing enough. We are, but when people say, oh, you can't achieve it, well, I sort of say, well, again, it's glass half empty, glass half full. Well, we can do it for some groups. I mean, this is doctors, and so because we've got census data, we know pretty much what every doctor is smoking status, just like any other occupation. So, you know, they started at 20% here, they've come down to about 3%. So there's a, and this is nurses, and you see this is a precipitous fall, and it's heading towards 5% or less, maybe at the next census. And when you look at, so we can look at every occupation you want to, and we have sufficient numbers because we got a census, we can say, look, there's a whole bunch of populations which are 5% or less already. This is 2013, and we're just, you know, we're waiting for the 2018 census, what that will show. But mathematicians, statisticians, you'd be pleased to know if there's any of those in the audience, they're very low. clergy, religious professionals, lots of health professionals, secondary school teachers, and there's a whole lot more who are close. So there's whole subsections of the population who are there or thereabouts already. Okay, so the 5% is not cloud cuckoo land. So that's a bit about sort of progress towards it, but one of the things we are worried about is the level of government commitment. So we keep pushing them to do more, and it is an uphill struggle, as it always is, you know, trying to persuade people to do stuff that you think they ought to. So one of the things we looked at was, well, how much are politicians, as a crude measure of political priority and commitment, how much are politicians talking about this Smokefree 2025 goal? So we did a sort of automated study where we had some databases of press releases and political speeches and sort of crawled through them to find mentions of tobacco and Smokefree 2025. And this is what we found. So these names won't mean much to you, but I'll explain. First of all, there weren't many mentions. So over a five-year period or so, there was maybe 100 mentions in all of these things. So it wasn't very prominent. More mentions of tobacco, but not many mentions of the goal. The people who were mentioning it most were these two here. And as you'll see, Tariana Turia, who I mentioned before, was by far and away the person who was talking about this goal. So she's committed. When she retired in September 2014, this was the guy who took over the portfolio. So he's had less time, but he's less committed on this admittedly crude measure. But he is mentioning it. But the worrying thing is these are associate ministers of health. We have two of those, and then we have the senior minister of health. The senior ministers of health are these two. Tony Ryland, and he retired in September 2014, and this guy took over. So between them, they've managed to mention it twice. This is a government goal. You know, it's supposedly something they're committed to. The senior ministers of health have mentioned it twice. I remember asking, and Tony Ryland almost seemed to go out of his way not to mention it. I was at a conference once where there were certain things that the government had done. It's a centre-right government, so they're not the greatest in public health terms sometimes. But he always trotted out certain things that they were doing, and one of them was smoking cessation in hospitals and primary care. And I got up and asked him a question, said, oh, you know, that minister, I was trying to be nice. You know, it's great that you've done all this stuff, but you haven't mentioned, you know, the best thing that you're doing for tobacco control, which is Smokefree 2025. And in his answer, he still wouldn't say Smokefree 2025. And you sort of think, he doesn't like it, you know. So that's a worry. So one of the things, if you've got an end game goal, you can try and get there with incremental things. You can try and up the mass media a bit. You can up the tax a bit. You can make the smoke-free things more extensive. Or you can go for some really radical things. And there's quite a few of these ideas. And this is a piece of research where we put some radical ideas to policymakers. So one is, we've got these 10% tax increases. We said, what about if you increased it 30%? And the context here is New Zealand has very high price for tobacco. It's about $20 a pack. So it's much higher than in the US. So a 30% increase, that's big. It makes it even more an expensive product, even more expensive. We said about retail restrictions, and the idea here was, what about if we dramatically reduce the availability of tobacco? So it's available in every corner store, in every gas station, in every supermarket, in every convenience store. What about if we said it was only available in a few stores, one store per town, or some sort of really radical reduction? Denicotinization is getting rid of the nicotine, mandating all cigarettes to be very low nicotine. Additives is getting rid of all the additives, mandated. And tobacco-free generation is the idea of increasing the age that you can purchase tobacco by year every year, so that for some people they will never legally be able to purchase tobacco. So these are pretty out there ideas. And this was how they went down, and by far the most supported one was the dramatic tax increases. And I think that's because people are familiar with it. It's actually, from a legislative point of view, it's pretty simple. You just put it in the budget, where some of these other things are much more complex to introduce and implement and monitor and so on. The one exception to that was with the retail restrictions. When we talked to Māori policymakers, they were much more positive about this. And I think that goes back to the original Māori idea of te peke kore, which is tobacco-free, which is they wanted this notion of, we don't want tobacco in our communities at all. It's not just about people not smoking. We don't want that shit in our communities. So they were much more in favour of that. But overall, people had lots of fishhooks with it. But this is sort of exploring, if we're going to push a big bang sort of solution, what's likely to work? I don't care how we do it in lots of ways. If we do it, that's great. It doesn't really matter how we do it. So point of sale displays. So this is just some of the research we did. So I said in 2012 we got rid of point of sale. But when I came to New Zealand, point of sale displays were not on the agenda at all. Research-wise, advocacy-wise, or whatever. Some places like Canada, I think Saskatchewan and a few states had introduced point-of-sale display bans. Thailand and Iceland had done it. So there was some interest, but not in New Zealand. And we just thought, oh, maybe this is something we should be looking at. So in New Zealand, there were some regulations about point-of-sale, which was things like you can only have 100 packs per point-of-sale. You couldn't have cigarette packs displayed next to children's products like candies and toys and things. They couldn't be visible from the outside. So there were some restrictions, but nevertheless, they were everywhere. So this sort of thing, these are the point of sales. So the first thing we did was, well, are these restrictions working? We did a student-led project, medical student project, where they went around about 300 gas stations and convenience stores and small corner shops called dairies in New Zealand, which I don't understand either, but anyway. So they went around 300 of these stores and had a look at the displays to see if they were complying with the regulations. There was quite a lot. This is a pretty minor thing about where the smoking kills sign was displayed. But more important, I think, about a quarter had them within a meter of children's products. About a quarter you could see from the outside, and about a sixth, there was more than 100 packs. So this showed that we used to say this legislation is not working. It's not being enforced properly. But it also sort of put this thing on the agenda. And this was where we had a stroke of luck. We presented this at a tobacco conference, and there happened to be a minister of health there in the previous government. And the medical students presented it, and they did a really good job, and they did it very innovatively. And the conference was really talking about this. And so the minister did his address. He didn't see the presentation, but he heard about it. And politicians are good at picking up the vibes. And he put into his address saying, oh, we're going to look at point of sale. And I really think this is one example where I can say, we did that, because I don't think there's any way that would have been in, except for the fact that it was in this conference. He just came out of it, out of the blue. So it put it on the agenda. So this is the sort of thing we're talking about. Here's the point of sale. These are chocolate bars and other candy bars and things. So this is a clear breach of the restrictions. So what we did then was we... The Cancer Society in New Zealand adopted this as their main advocacy target, and ASH New Zealand, and so there's a campaign, and we did research to help with that campaign. So it was really, you know, it had a point to it. And we did a systematic review. We looked at international experience in places like Thailand and Canada. We did some public opinion research. And then the things I'm just going to mention are these ones here. So the first thing, we did some qualitative research with smokers to find out about the point of sale displays and were they having an impact. And so these were some of the things that the smokers said. So first of all, they're really, really obvious. So they're the first thing inside the door. They're right smack bang in front of you. You can't miss them. And then this one going a bit further and saying, look, they tempt people. These displays tempt people. So this is smokers or recent ex-smokers talking about them. And then this one, was quite evocative. Look, it's all I would look at when I quit smoking and when I went to the dairy or the petrol station, that's a gas station, it made me long for a smoke when I saw them. And then this one, yeah, I'd see the smokes and that would trigger me to buy a packet. So, you know, it's qualitative research and that has its pros and cons, but I think it's quite rich data and it illustrates how these things are working with smokers. And then we talked to some retailers, and this was more like a pilot study, if I'm honest, but just about 8 or 9 retailers. But there were national retailing organizations which were all adamantly opposed to a point of sale display ban. And they were saying the usual sort of stuff, you know, the world's going to end if you do that. It's absolutely terrible. It restricts freedom. All the retailers hate it, all that sort of stuff. So we said, oh, well, let's talk to some retailers and see what they think. So one of the things was that they were very clear, some of the retailers, about what these displays were for and why they were there. So one of them said, quite clearly said, well, the tobacco companies pay us. That's why they're there. So if there's any doubt about that, and, you know, I'm sure you know, but everything in a retail environment is carefully thought through and paid for. And then they said things like this. If you've got something on display and people see it, then they'll buy it. If you've got it hidden away somewhere, they won't see it and they won't buy it. So, the official line was this is about brand choice and all that. And, of course, we know people actually don't change their brands very much, so it's a nonsense. But the retailers were saying none of that stuff. They were saying, no, it encourages people to buy it. And then this one was the most revealing, I think. Well, the only point of displaying anything is to introduce people to it. It just encourages the young kids. And that's a retailer talking. So that was quite illuminating. And then, and what we found was that overall, there was a mix. Some retailers were saying, look, leave us alone, this is fine. We don't need any more regulation or whatever. But quite a few said, no, we'd get on with it, wouldn't bother us. And some said they'd actively support it. It was a mixed picture, but not the picture that the industry was sort of saying. Now, this one was a particularly sort of revealing one. This was a very senior manager in a big supermarket chain. So said, we see tobacco as a sunset category. And we definitely see a point when it would be very difficult to buy tobacco. And then went on to say, the sooner we can stop selling it, the better. And this was their personal view, I should say. But, you know, we've got values, it's important to us, we're doing a disservice to our consumers. We don't like selling this stuff. We don't want to sell this stuff. You know, and this is not the picture you get from the... And even talking to just everyday retailers, that's quite often a sentiment, not but amongst all by any means. Some just don't care, but some do. You know, they don't like selling it. And then the other thing we did was, there's quite a lot of research, mainly out of California, about the association between point-of-sale displays or point-of-sale advertising and experimentation with smoking amongst kids. And we sort of presented this stuff to policymakers, and they would say things like, oh, yeah, but that's California, you know, that's different. And we'd say, no, you know, kids are pretty much the same everywhere. It probably is exactly the same here. But eventually say, oh, okay, we'll see if it works in New Zealand as well. So we have a big survey of year 10, which in New Zealand is 14 to 15-year-old kids, and there's about 25,000 have a smoking prevalence survey every year. And we inserted some questions into that survey. And one of the questions we inserted was how often they visited the shops where tobacco is sold. And then what we could do was see if there's an association between visiting the shops more often and experimenting with tobacco, and that's exactly what we found. So these are the reference group who didn't visit very often at all. Those who visited most days, they were about 2.5 times more likely to have experimented with smoking. So this we were able to say to people, surprise, surprise, it applies in New Zealand as well. So we did eventually get point of sale displays removed. how much did our research make a difference? I think actually not much, if I'm honest. This came down to some political machinations. I'm sure it helped a little bit. And as I said, I do think it put it on the agenda. But it came down to coalition politics, and the Māori Party wanted some serious tobacco control stuff. I don't think the government was so committed or bothered, but they went along with it as to keep themselves in power and so on. So it happened. So that was good. And then afterwards, we didn't leave it there. We thought this ought to be evaluated. And of course, one of the frustrating things in New Zealand and probably here is you introduce these things and then there's no evaluation. And I think that's frustrating on a local level because you can never give feedback to people that this has worked or hasn't worked. But also on an international level, we need to build up the evidence base. So nothing happened, so we sort of did it for them. And we used the same survey. And what we were able to show was that things like experimentation with smoking and current smoking and initiation of smoking, they all went down. Now, this is just a before-after study, so it could have gone down for other reasons. Possibly tax, but nevertheless, it was all in the right direction. The other thing that we did, which I think was quite neat, was we repeated that first study in 2014 to see whether there was still an association between frequency of visiting stores and experimenting with smoking. And what we found was that this association either disappeared or was greatly reduced. And I think that's quite neat because That really does, you know, that can only be an impact of the point of sale display ban, as far as I can see. Nothing else changed in those establishments. So we were able to show some difference. So, you know, that's a little program of work we did with a policy orientation. So some other things that we've done, and I'll just go through a few examples. We've done some stuff on smoking in cars, which Ryan will be familiar with. He's done much better studies than this. But we did one quite early. I think it was quite early on, and the cool thing, so it's a particulate monitor, and we got these levels of particulates in the car, and this was in my car. We were driving around with a person from my department smoking, and that in the back seat on a children's seat, just to show what would happen to a child strapped into a seat, and it went up to about 3,000 with the windows closed. And we'd done quite a few studies in smoky pubs, and it goes up to, most we ever got up to was about 1,100. So this is absolutely astonishing levels of pollution. And even with the window fully down, it was about 200, which is about the average in a smoky pub in studies we've done. So, and this got an enormous amount of publicity. I mean, it was a rubbish study. It was just, we just drove around for an hour and had a few traces and did a letter, but it got loads of publicity, which is one of the things with policy research. Sometimes your things hit and you can't work out why. And other times you do a beautiful study and no one shows any interest whatsoever. Well, that's life. This is one. George Thompson does a lot of work, observational work, looking at where people smoke. This is in Wellington, with a particular focus on where are children exposed to smoking. Not in the sense so much of secondhand smoke, but people smoking and them seeing it. And this ties in with sort of smoke-free cities, and we've used this with Wellington City Council to try and say, well, what about if you made the middle of Wellington completely smoke-free and, you know, badged yourself as a smoke-free city? So that's some interesting work he's done. This is one looking at health warnings, and we've got pretty good health warnings, particularly on the back, so they're 90%. But the number on the back here, the quitline number, I mean, I think that's pretty difficult to see. And this is the current warning. And so Janet Hook, who's my co-director, has done a lot of work on choice experiments and things. And here she's got a much clearer display of the number, and she used a heat map technique where people clicked on bits of the pack which encouraged them or supported them to quit. And you see how the quit line now, there was no clicks on it here, and now you've got this really hot area, and also the message. So that's, and we're hoping that actually the packs are, the health warnings are about to be changed, and we hope that this will be one of the changes. We're pretty sure it will be. Janet's also done some things looking at dissuasive sticks. So there's the idea of plain packaging, which you're probably all familiar with, but this, you may not be quite so familiar with this one. Taking the thing to the logical next step, we'll say, well, why don't we make the sticks themselves unpleasant to use and handle and be seen with? So this is the standard one, and then various varieties. So this is like the plain packaging colour. This is another colour we thought would be aversive. This, I think this is in the wrong place. It should be moved down. But this has shown that the ranking got less and less, and the aversiveness became more and more negative in a choice experiment. And this one, with the minutes of life lost, was particularly effective. So the next generation things, why don't we think about the sticks? We've put that to the policymakers, and they're thinking about it, but I doubt it. But it's something to consider. We've done a lot of stuff on retail and where tobacco is sold. As I say, it's sold in pretty much all the commonly visited retail locations in New Zealand. This is where we actually, we have no register or no licensing or anything like that in New Zealand. So this was actually documenting where all the locations are, and then showing how there's a socioeconomic gradient in that, as you might expect. The deprived areas have more retailers. And this is mapping them using sort of GIS-type approaches around schools and showing just what proportion of schools have tobacco retailers right next to them within 500 metres or a kilometre, and what, if you restricted that, what proportion of retailers would that take out? And this has been the basis for a lot of other work that some of our researchers are looking at. This is an e-cigarette project. We're starting to get into this. This is one that Janet's doing. It's using a smart e-cigarette. So this e-cigarette sends information to a smartphone app about usage patterns and puff patterns and intensity of puff and so on. So it's really looking at dual users and how they use e-cigarettes and tobacco and so on. So that's a feasibility study using this smart e-cigarette. One of the things we've looked at very closely is young people smoking. In New Zealand, as in the US, there's been this dramatic decline. This is the European, so this is sort of about the overall figure. It's gone down to about 13% to about 3% for daily smoking. So this is an incredible success story. Not that we really know how we've done it, I don't think, but it's happened. And even amongst Māori, it was incredibly high, 14 to 15-year-olds here, and it really has come down. It's still far too high, but it's really come down. So this is good. But then if you look at smoking prevalence a little higher up, at say 20 to 24, this is 2013, it's about 23%, and amongst Māori it's about 40%. So I would say, well, okay, so we've got smoking prevalence down to 4% in 14 to 15-year-olds, which is good, but what if we have achieved if by the time they're 20 or 24, it's 24%? And if you think it's 60 years since Winder and Graham and Dolan Hill and the lung cancer studies, 60 years later, a quarter of our young people, 40% of Māori young people, are entering adulthood as smokers. I mean, that's a catastrophic failure of prevention, I would say. Because we then got to try and get them off smoking. And many of them, of course, won't. So we really wanted to focus on this sort of late uptake, if you like, and what's happening. And this is looking at initiation. If you look at the darker bars here, this is a cohort study looking at how people take up smoking. And what it shows is that it's substantial at 15 to 17, still substantial, nearly 4%, 18 to 19, 20 to 24, 2%, and then it pretty much disappears. So the message here is pretty much no one starts smoking after 25 anymore. If you can get people to 25 in New Zealand, and I think this is probably true in a lot of places, you've pretty much cracked it. They're never going to smoke. So in terms of preventing long-term, that's a key audience to aim at. It's a really difficult audience because we all know that 20 to 24-year-olds don't like being told what to do, etc. And they're a dispersed and difficult to reach audience. So that's where this. So some of this research, I think, informed the fact that we've now got this campaign, which is aimed at that audience. One of the other things we did was looking at whether smoking is a true informed choice, which is the tobacco industry rhetoric. And I'd just say very quickly. Essentially, we don't think it is. And we looked at 20 to 24-year-olds who had started smoking, not as kids as 14 to 15, but had started later. And are they showing an informed choice? I'll perhaps just go. We've come up with a framework. It's like a medical model framework of like going for a screening test or something. What do you need to know for informed choice? Because deciding to smoke is a major life-changing decision with profound health implications. So what would you really need to know? And this comes out of our qualitative study, you need to take an active conscious decision. Lots of people don't, they just drift into it. You need to not be cognitively impaired, i.e. you don't need to be drunk. How do you take an informed choice when you're drunk? And yet lots of people start smoking when they're out in the pub. And also they're with friends and they're under social pressure and so on. You also need to understand all the health risks, you need to know the severity, you need to personalize those health risks, and you need to understand addiction, and we found that very few young people understood addiction. They didn't think they would be continuing to smoke. So when you think of it in this terms, almost no one takes an informed choice to smoke. And that introduces some thoughts about, well, if that's the case, we need to protect, either enhance their ability or protect them, which is slightly different, difficult grounds, but the sort of smoke-free generation idea could be underpinned by that sort of thinking. We need to protect these people until they're 25 or so, because then they probably will be more likely to make an informed choice and they won't start. I'll flip through that. So the last thing, we're part of the ITC project, so that will help with our looking at policy and interventions. We've also got a Māori ITC type project, which is led by Anna Ruwa, who's pictured there. So we're going to specifically look at a cohort of Māori smokers and recent quitters and what impacts policy has on them. So we'll be hopefully generating lots more information as Smokefree 2025 rolls out. We do a lot of media work. You know, we try and put out press releases. We try and get people over. This was, we brought Frank Chalupka over. It's often useful to bring outside experts in to talk to policymakers. And we're on Twitter. I don't think we do it very well, but we try. And we do blogs and things. And we find these quite useful, not for the public so much, but for policymakers and journalists. So they're quite informed and they're referenced, but they're not journal articles. So it's to try and get across messages to people, but not having to read the whole journal article. And finally, just to talk about endgames, there's now a bunch of countries that have endgames, and Canada should be added to this, and they're consulting about their strategy at the moment. It's beginning to take hold, and a lot of them do have, we have no action plan. A lot of the countries now do have an action plan for how they propose to achieve these endgames. We don't have one. So are endgames a good idea? Well, I think they're great, and the reasons I think they're really good idea is a philosophical one. They're a paradigm shift in thinking. They're not saying we want to reduce smoking, they're saying we want to eliminate it. There's no bullshit, we want to get rid of it. It's going beyond a sort of status quo thinking, because that means if you're going to do that, if we're going to get Māori smoking down from 40% now in about 7 or 8 years, well, we've got to do some pretty radical things. And so it opens you up to some of those thinking about other ideas. And it galvanizes it. It is an inspiring vision for people like me, for the public, sometimes for policymakers, the media. It's something people can get behind. We know what we're trying to achieve. It's a real vision. And it keeps us on the agenda. There's a goal. We can keep, every time the government doesn't do anything, we say, well, what about Smokefree 2025? What are you doing? We can keep harping on about it. And I think in itself, it could be an intervention as a sort of the writing's on the wall for smoking. For a lot of smokers, they might say, oh, this is, it could be the final thing, or it could be a contributor to deciding to quit. It's actually, you're not going to be able to get hold of it so easily. No one's going to be smoking soon. That remains to be seen, but I think it's potential. What are the negatives? I don't think there's many. The negatives are mainly the government hasn't done all the things we would hope it would. We don't think the government's got sufficient priority. There's no action plan. At the moment, it's just like, oh, we got Smokefree 2025 and we're going to drift towards it. Well, you know, that's not going to happen. And we don't, although there's a lot of support for it, it's not active support. We haven't got a real social movement behind it, like we have with, say, nuclear-free New Zealand. It's passive support. And one of the things we need is much more sort of mass media for it. And this, I put this up just because this is something that appeared in New Zealand. New Zealand has a goal to be smoke-free by 2025. So you might think, oh, that's a government campaign. It's not. This is Pfizer. So this is actually pushing whatever NRT or varenicline or whatever it is they're pushing. But it, I mean, it's good. I mean, it's great that they're doing it. But, you know, why isn't the government doing that? Because they never have. So it's frustrating because you can sort of almost touch it and think we could do this with a bit more oomph, a bit more commitment, we could get there. We'd have a chance, but we're probably not at the rate we're going. So I'll leave it there. Kia ora, thank you. And there's a few contact details.
I'm Chris Foster, I work for a pension in the US. Not affiliated with your ranch, but good friend of them. I was wondering if what the experience of using litigation in New Zealand has been. I know civil litigation has been a big deal here, and for the past several years, we've been looking into criminal litigation.
Right.
In fact, Shane Bradbrook is a huge proponent. We've been working with him for years on that. But I wondered, I'm not aware of the big lawsuits in New Zealand that we've seen.
No, it's not been a big feature of the New Zealand scene, and there's a few reasons for that. I mean, one is that it's a much less litigious culture. People don't go straight to their lawyers all the time. So it's just not sort of part of the way we do things, really. There was a case, it's called the Janet Poe case, about a lady who died from lung cancer, and essentially they lost. The tobacco industry won, and that's also put a lot of people off. There was a lot of effort put into that to try and hold the industry accountable, and the court ruled against them, or the jury came against them. But there is stuff through what's called the Waitangi Tribunal. So New Zealand has a founding document called the Treaty of Waitangi, which protects Māori and the rights of Māori in New Zealand. So although Māori have certainly suffered through colonisation, they've also, in some ways, they've suffered less, and they've preserved their rights and things better than, say, Aboriginal Australians. And Shane is one of the people who's been looking towards taking a case to the Waitangi Tribunal, which is a sort of judicial type approach, to say the government has failed to protect Māori. And there's actually quite a lot of email traffic going on around that at the moment, formulating how we might do that. So there might be something along those lines, but it's not eventuated yet.
Richard, you showed earlier on an acknowledgement slide with a lot of partners that you're working with, and you implied that there were some strong advocates. So are they working on strategies to really try and push the Smokefree 2025 forward, or where does that stand in terms of civil society?
Oh, very much. So I say there's no government strategy. In fact, although about a year and a half ago, they said they were going to create one, but it's never appeared. But we created one for them. But it's like the sector's strategy. So it was a mixture of the advocacy groups, academics, and practitioners came up with a strategy. But you know, it has no government official blessing, and the ministry doesn't bless it, Ministry of Health. At the moment, we're doing a review, and we're going to come up with a revised strategy, and we're hoping to try and make this a very credible one. So yeah, we're certainly working on that, and we're hoping to almost embarrass the government. I mean, they don't like strategies. They sort of say, oh, we're just doing the right things. And you say, well, how do you know what the right things are? But they have got a strategy for childhood obesity. I would say it's not very good, but they have got a strategy. So in principle, they do strategies, but they're just very reluctant. So we're doing everything we can to give them a strategy and to push them, but we haven't succeeded yet.
Can you comment a little bit about electronic cigarettes, and is that part of the end game, or is it just not recognized?
Well, I guess it's like everywhere else. It's sort of controversial or debated as to what their contribution to the end game is, and there's people on sort of all sides of the fence on that. So at the moment, e-cigarettes are not legally available for sale in New Zealand. They can be imported for personal use, that's legal, and they are in practice sold under the counter in specialist vape shops. So that's, nicotine-containing e-cigarettes. Non-nicotine-containing you can buy, but nicotine-containing e-cigarettes and e-liquids are not legally available for sale. But in practice, people can get them. And there are various people who are pushing very hard that they should be made much more widely available, and the government has a consultation out at the moment about making them much more widely available. As a sector, we've got together to try and get some consensus, because it creates a lot of disunity, just like it does everywhere. And we've managed that with people at quite different ends of the spectrum. And what we've suggested is that e-cigarettes are made available for sale, nicotine-containing ones, through pharmacies, because you can have smoking cessation and it's a more clinical environment, more controlled, and also specialist vape shops who are licensed, and they have to have some basic cessation training. And we think that might constrain it somewhat and protect children largely from using it, and that might be a reasonable sort of halfway house. We would argue that we shouldn't make them available everywhere, because once you do that, it's very difficult to roll it back, and we don't see yet the clear evidence that has a big beneficial effect in reducing smoking. It might do, and in which case, if that becomes clear, we could change the policy. So that's the position at the moment. We're waiting to see what the government says, but I suspect they will actually make them available pretty much everywhere. That's my best guess. But it's sort of watch this space. And there are some people who, outside of our consensus group, who want them made available everywhere, and also almost think it's the whole answer, that other tobacco control is less important, it's all about e-cigarettes. I really don't share that view. I think whatever you do with e-cigarettes, you continue with the other tobacco control stuff as a complementary measure to e-cigarettes, even if you believe they are a big part of the solution.
How about two last questions?
So my question, I'm thinking about the population size of New Zealand, and a lot of the work or the countries that we work with at IGTC are very large countries, large populations. And so I'm thinking about how transferable are the methods and the practices that many have implemented in New Zealand when thinking about these larger populations where, one, they are some of the largest producers of tobacco, and I'm not certain if that even is happening in New Zealand, and you know, so much money is being generated and given to the government because of the sale of tobacco. So yeah. If you can just talk about how transferable are, you know, what you've done to these other larger populations in terms of just getting at reducing tobacco use, banning various things as well.
Yeah. So New Zealand has a population of about 4.5 million, so it's tiny compared to, you know, a lot of countries. The reason I think it's quite interesting is it could be an exemplar if we did it. It could be an exemplar to other places. I think the idea of an end game is transferable. I think the pathway to an end game is probably every time is going to be context specific. And I don't think if New Zealand does it in a certain way, that means, I don't know, Brazil or Indonesia or somewhere else should do it in the same way. I think that's ridiculous. You know, places need to find their own way and what works in their context. Having said that, I do think a lot of things are transferable. Like the stuff I said about point of sale. You know, kids are influenced by marketing and stuff, whether they're, you know, whatever country they're from, whatever ethnicity or background they're from. I think there's a whole lot of stuff in tobacco control that is highly transferable. But I think the implementation, you do have to work through local, whatever's appropriate locally, what the opportunities are locally. You know, sometimes it's just you have to be a little bit opportunistic and respect the fact that people will get there in different ways, and I think that's absolutely fine. I don't think New Zealand should be a blueprint, but I think it could be a blueprint in the sense, if we do it, that you can do it. And if we can do it, so can other places.
Could you... noting that the Pacific Island countries have a similar goal, could you elaborate a little bit on your collaboration, if there is any, with them and pursuing that goal? It's the reverse of what Carmen just asked, but to smaller countries.
Yeah, so Pacific Island, some of those countries are absolutely tiny. One of the ones we've been talking with is Tokelau, and I think it has about 200 smokers. I mean, it's incredible. I mean, some like Samoa and Tonga and Fiji are bigger. But they're small populations. So New Zealand has a particular sort of geographical proximity relative. I mean, New Zealand's miles from anywhere, but if it's close to anywhere, it's close to Australia and the Pacific Island countries. But also we have a big Pacific population in New Zealand, and that population is often newly immigrated from Pacific Island countries, and they also go back and forth because they have strong family links. So we feel we have a sort of responsibility, if you like, for us, we're the sort of big, usually New Zealand's the little guy, but this time we're the big guy compared to the Pacific Island countries. But we also have, those countries are developing countries, and we have a responsibility to help and support tobacco controls in those countries. Having said that, we're really at a pretty nascent early stage with that. We haven't done a lot so far. There certainly has been some, not so much from our group, but some other people, tobacco control people in New Zealand, have done some work in Pacific Islands. And there's been a lot of work on non-communicable diseases, and obesity is a really big issue in Pacific Island countries. So we're really hoping to develop that. And we've been talking recently with the WHO representatives from that region and just trying to work out what can we contribute, what's appropriate for us to contribute. And I used to work quite a lot in sub-Saharan Africa, so I'm sort of quite philosophically wedded to working in developing countries, and I haven't been able to do that. So this is a sort of local opportunity to contribute something. So we're hoping to sort of watch this space. But there are some potential, because these islands are tiny, they can go under the radar, potentially. But also, they're very isolated. Like in Tokelau, the tobacco really is brought in on the boat once a month. So we've been talking about, say, denicotinization. You could do it there. You know, you could. There's only one retailer that sells tobacco. You could say, right, mandated denicotinized cigarettes. That's what you're getting. It's possible, and that could be a test case. So you could test some radical things if people agree to it, obviously locally, which maybe just wouldn't be possible in a bigger jurisdiction. So I think there are some interesting, exciting possibilities in the Pacific.
That's great. Thank you so much. It was a terrific presentation and very inspiring to hear about this aspirational goal. So.